great blessing and honor to have with us Roger Callistus. Roger Callistus is in Buffalo because this, the next week he's here for the meeting of the International Commission for Anglican Orthodox Dialogue. This is the International Commission of Dialogue between the Orthodox Church and the Church of the Anglican Community. So they will meet next week in Buffalo. But Roger Callistus is the chairman, the Orthodox Church chairman of the dialogue on behalf of the Ecumenical Community. So since he was coming anyway, we invited him to come also a few days earlier, and he was very kind to accept the invitation. He's giving us his lectures and talks in the area. One of his talks will happen right now, and this one will be about the relations, the current state of the relations of the Orthodox and the Roman Catholic Churches. Roger Callistus knows a lot about this subject because he has a great experience over the years about the relations of the two churches, but also he is a member currently of the official dialogue between the two churches. I talked about the Anglican Orthodox dialogue, but the Roman Catholic Orthodox dialogue is very important. It's the most important dialogue of the Orthodox Church, and the Roman Council is a member of the Commission, has a great experience. And he can tell us actually what's going on right now, what is the current state, what is the discussion now. And he might give us also a history of this subject. So we're very blessed to have him with us. The Roman Callistus is a well-known theologian, a professor at the University of Oxford, many years, and also many articles and books. Maybe many of you know the Orthodox Church. The book of the Roman Catholic is the best known book about the Orthodox Church in the English speaking world. Many have become Orthodox either because of the book or because of a lecture or a talk of His Eminence. So we're very honored, Your Eminence, to have you with us. I want to welcome to the Roman Catholic.
We Orthodox are engaged in such dialogues with the Episcopalians, that's the Anglican Communion, with the Old Catholics, with the Lutherans, with the Evangelicals, with the Oriental Orthodox. But for us Orthodox, the most important of all these dialogues is that which we have with the Roman Catholic Church. This dialogue was inaugurated in 1980 on the island of Patmos in the monastery to which I belong, though I was not present at that occasion. One incident that happened during the beginning of the dialogue shows that not everybody is in favor of dialogue. While all the delegates were assembled in church for the inaugural service, some of the monks of the monastery mounted up to the roof and they lowered the flag, which was flying, the Byzantine double-headed eagle, yellow flag. They lowered that and they raised another black flag saying, "Orthodoxy or death." Well, despite that beginning, the dialogue continued. produced three convergence documents. Munich in 1982, Bari in 1987, Palermo in 1988. It was decided that they would not begin with the points of contention from the past, which had divided the Orthodox and Catholic churches, because there would be a danger that the two sides would merely repeat what they had been saying from their well-supplied arsenal of polemic in previous centuries. So they adopted an oblique approach, and the opening documents dealt in general terms with the Church, with the Eucharist, with the ministry, and also they discussed the subject of Unitism, that is to say, the position of the Eastern Catholic churches that are in communion with Rome. It was only at Ravenna in 2007 that the dialogue produced a convergence document on what is surely for both Catholics and Orthodox the main point at issue, the papal primacy. Obviously, papal infallibility is also a central issue, but we haven't yet begun to consider this. I was present at the Ravenna meeting, and what struck me particularly was the great numbers of police everywhere. There were police officers outside our hotel. There were police outside the hall where we were having our meetings. There were police lining the route from the hotel to the hall. And I asked myself, what are all these police doing here? Is it to prevent the delegates in the dialogue from fighting together? Is it to protect the delegates from the people of Ravenna? Or is it to protect the people of Ravenna? Now, unfortunately, the Ravenna statement has been rejected by one of the leading Orthodox churches, the Church of Russia. And we are now trying to draft another agreed statement dealing with the primacy, but we haven't advanced very far. Now, in reflecting about Christian unity, it is helpful to keep in mind the words of a great Russian Orthodox pioneer in the movement for Christian reconciliation, Father Sergius Bulgakov, who died in 1944. And Father Sergius says, unity is something we already possess and are still seeking. So unity is both gift and task. We already have a deep unity as Christians, but we need to struggle to make the expression of that unity more complete. So unity is both a present possession and a future hope. We have to hold in balance the already and the not yet. In the case of Orthodoxy and Rome, there is an impressively large amount that we already possess in common. We have the same faith in Jesus Christ as fully and completely divine, fully and completely human, one person in two natures. As St. Leo the Great said, totus in suis, totus in nostris. Christ is full and complete in what is his own, his Godhead, but he's also full and complete in what is ours, his manhood. We have a common faith then in the cross, the resurrection, and the second coming of our Lord. We have a common faith in the Holy Trinity, apart from the question of the procession of the Holy Spirit, to which I shall come in a moment. We have a common faith in the communion of saints. In both our traditions, we invoke the intercessions of the Holy Ones. We have a shared devotion to the Holy Mother of God. We both believe in the Eucharist as the true body and blood of Christ, what St. Ignatius of Antioch called pharmakon athanasias, the medicine of immortality, the guarantee that we shall not die, but live forever in Christ. All of this then, as Catholics and as Orthodox, we share in common. But then, as well as the already, there's also the not yet. There are matters where we are still seeking unity. And here I would single out four areas. First of all, there is the procession of the Holy Spirit. The debate about the filioque clause in the Creed. Historically, this has been the chief cause of East-West conflict. Yet, even here, let us not lose sight of the common ground that we share. We agree, Orthodox and Catholics, that the Holy Spirit is a person, a hypostasis. Once I heard him described by an Orthodox speaker as a sacred blast, but that is not what we believe concerning him. He is a living person, and as person, he is equal to the Father and the Son, worshipped with them, not below them. The one point where we differ concerns the procession of the Holy Spirit. Does the Holy Spirit proceed from the Father only, or does he proceed from the Father and the Son jointly? As you will doubtless know, the West added to the Creed, where the original text of the Creed, as blessed by the Nicene and Constantinople Council, says that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father. In the West, the word filioque was added so that it now reads from the Father and from the Son. But just how important is this difference? St. Augustine, in his work De Trinitate, made a distinction between the procession of the Spirit from the Father and his procession from the Son. He said that the Spirit proceeds from the Father principaliter de patre, principally from the Father, whereas the Spirit proceeds from the Son only per donum patris, through the gift of the Father. In other words, the Father, in Augustine's view, is the ultimate source within the Trinity, the fountainhead of Godhead. And if the Spirit proceeds also from the Son, it is the Father who has conferred that gift of power on the Son. Now, this, I think, is not so very different from what St. Gregory of Nyssa said and other Orthodox say, that the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father through the Son. Yes, we have in the Orthodox Church, hawks and doves. And the hawks say that this question of the procession of the Holy Spirit is immensely important. But the doves say, do not overemphasize this. If the West would omit the insertion into the creed of the words and from the Son, then we could discuss the procession of the Spirit from the Son as a theologuna, as a theological opinion, though not a dogma. Well, perhaps you'll be relieved to hear I am a dove rather than a hawk. Now, the second area which has given difficulty between Orthodox and Catholics is the question of purgatory. We Orthodox do not use the actual word purgatory, but in common with Catholics, we pray for the departed, and we are confident that such prayers benefit them. Now here, the question at issue is, how do you envisage purgatory? Do you think of it as a place of punishment or a place of healing? Do you think of purgatory as a prison or as a hospital? Now, in the Catholic tradition, there are notable witnesses who emphasize the therapeutic approach. For example, St. Catherine of Genoa, or Cardinal Newman in his great poem, The Dream of Gerontius. Now, as an Orthodox, if the idea of purgatory is not spelled out in terms of punishment, not spelled out in legalistic terms, but rather pastorally, in therapeutic terms, then I, as an Orthodox, don't have any great trouble over the Catholic teaching concerning purgatory. Then a third area of difficulty between Catholics and Roman and Orthodox is the doctrine of the Immaculate Conception of the Blessed Virgin Mary. We Orthodox agree with the Catholics that the Holy Virgin is free from all actual personal sin. We call her Panagia, all holy. We call her Akrantos, spotless. We call her Hyper Evlogimene, most highly blessed. But the normal Orthodox view is to argue that she was not exempt from the effects of original sin. That she was, from that point of view, on a level with, for example, St. John the Baptist. I think the real point at issue here is not the honor and love we show for the Holy Virgin. It is a question of how do we understand original sin? Does it imply inherited guilt, as St. Augustine taught? Does it mean that the whole human race are the objects of God's wrath? Well, in the Orthodox East, we do not, on the whole, make use of this idea of an inherited guilt. We think that the fall has involved an inherited weakness. It has certain physical consequences. We are subject to disease and death because of the fall. We suffer from a weakness of will because of the fall. But we are not guilty, in a personal way, of Adam's sin. So for us Orthodox, the doctrine of the Immaculate Conception is not so much untrue as unnecessary. If we held the Augustinian view of inherited guilt, then indeed we would wish to say that the Blessed Virgin could not possibly be the object of God's wrath. But we don't hold that approach to original sin. I feel we need not overemphasize this point. Can we not be content to say simply, the Holy Virgin is sinless and most pure, and let's leave original sin out of it? Let's remember that in Christian dialogue, there is always a danger of trying to say too much. As St. Basil insisted, let things ineffable be honored with silence. I remember a friend of mine who came back some time ago from an interfaith conference in California. And first of all, the Jewish rabbi got up and he told a few jokes and he sat down. Then the Japanese Zen Buddhist, Roshi, got up and he uttered a few enigmatic koans and then he sat down. After that, my friend said, the Christians got up. And they talked and they talked. And they had so much to say where they agreed, where they differed. And my friend thought to himself, how clever they are. How do they know so much about God? And then he thought, if they know so much about God, why can't they just be quiet? So what remains? I've mentioned three things that might be difficulties between us, Orthodox and Catholics: the possession of the Holy Spirit, the state of the departed, and the Immaculate Conception of Our Lady. What remains? Papal claims, primacy and infallibility. As regards primacy, the key question is, does the Pope possess supreme ordinary jurisdiction over the Christian East? And here, surely we should take as our criterion the first millennium of Christian history. What was the role of the Bishop of Rome in the communion of the churches during the first 1,000 years when Christian East and Christian West were in full communion together? That, I would think, should be our decisive test. And as regards papal infallibility, our question is, does the Pope possess a special charisma veritatis, a charism of the truth that is not given to other bishops? And if so, by what sacramental act is this charisma conferred? Because the gifts of grace are conferred through sacraments. It's interesting to reflect on the priority. At the last major occasion when Catholics and Orthodox met together, that was the Council of Ferrara, Florence, in 1438-39, regarded on the Catholic side as an ecumenical council, but rejected by the Orthodox. On that occasion, the members of the council spent about 10 months on and off discussing the filioque and the procession of the Holy Spirit. They spent about 4 months discussing the question of purgatory. But as regards the papal claims, they spent only 10 days. 10 months on the question of the Holy Spirit and the procession, 10 days on the role of the Pope in the Church. That was the order of priorities at that time. They didn't discuss the question of the Immaculate Conception because that was not yet the universal teaching in the West. After all, the doctrine of the Immaculate Conception was only proclaimed in 1854. So at that time it hadn't emerged as a point of difficulty between Orthodox and Catholics. Today, I am sure our priorities will be different. Today, surely, we shall regard the papal claims as the most difficult issue. And if we, Orthodox and Catholics, can come to an agreement on that, then I think the other questions can be more easily solved. Let me set before you a statement about the papacy that was made by a very wise Orthodox who called himself the monk of the Eastern Church, a Frenchman, Father Lev Gillet, in a letter to Dom Olivier Rousseau of Chevreuil, editor of the journal Irenicon. And this dates from 1947, but I think it's still highly relevant. Referring to the place of Rome in the communion of the churches, Father Lev says, "This primacy of humility, service, and love, those are the terms that he wants to apply to the role of the Pope. Not power of jurisdiction, but humility, service, and love. Surely the present Pope, Francis, has in a very striking way emphasized those elements and therefore changed the whole atmosphere in which the papal claims are discussed. Humility, service, and love." Barlev goes on that thinking of papal primacy, we should not see it simply as a primacy of honor or a nebulous sort of leadership. We should see it, he says, as a unique pastoral mission. And he says three elements need to be combined together in our assessment of this unique pastoral mission. First of all, it is important to emphasize freedom in the Holy Spirit. We should not leave out of account the voice of the Holy Paraclete speaking in the conscience of every baptized member of the people of God. That's the first factor, what in Roman Catholic theology is called sensus fidelium, the sense of the faithful. And in Orthodoxy we speak of the general conscience of the Church. Then, a second factor we take into account looking at the Pope's ministry is holy tradition, which for Orthodox means especially the seven ecumenical councils, though that's not an exhaustive criterion, since other councils are taken into account in Orthodoxy's understanding of tradition. So holy tradition is expressed above all in a conciliar form. And when stressing the primacy of the Pope, then we need to leave a place for the collegiality of the bishops. And thirdly, says Father Lev, some Orthodox might disagree, there is the charisma of Peter, the unique position of the Bishop of Rome as successor of Peter. Some writers think of all the bishops as being successors of Peter. That's an idea you can find in St. Cyprian's text on the unity of the Church. But surely we may agree, Orthodox and Catholics, that the Bishop of Rome is a successor of Peter in a special sense. And there are two papal titles that appeal particularly to the Orthodox. The first is the phrase, care of all the churches, solicitudo omnium ecclesiarum. That phrase, found in St. Paul, 2 Corinthians 11:28, was applied to the papal office by Pope Siricius, the end of the 4th century, by Pope Innocent I at the beginning of the 5th century, and by others. Care of all the churches. Notice the word all. If you apply that phrase to the Pope, and I as an Orthodox am happy to do so, we remember that all includes the East as well as the West. And the second papal title that appeals to us Orthodox is Servus Servorum Dei, used by Pope Gregory the Great, the end of the 6th century of his office as Pope. Care of all the church, the servant of the servants of God. Both these titles are pastoral rather than juridical. They speak of service, of diaconia, rather than superior power. Now, I believe as an Orthodox that if Roman primacy is spelt out in this way, rather than in the language of the First Vatican Council, then the papal claims need not be an insuperable obstacle between Orthodox and Catholics. So my appeal to the Catholics here present this afternoon is Father Lev's formulation a unique pastoral ministry sufficient, or do you want to assert something more? Let me close by calling to mind two statements, one by an Orthodox and the other by a Catholic. First, from the Orthodox side, here is the Ecumenical Patriarch Athenagoras, Patriarch of Constantinople, speaking in 1968. Today, he says, union is the ananke, our necessary destiny. And he went on to say, union will be a miracle, but a miracle in history. My second quotation is from Cardinal Soenens of Belgium. In order to unite, we must first love one. In order to love one another, we must first get to know one another. Taken together, these two statements, the one Orthodox and the other Catholic, provide the motive and the justification for our current Catholic Orthodox dialogue. First then, union is the ananke. It is our vocation as followers of Christ. We seek unity because it is Christ's will. For what did our Lord pray at the Last Supper with his disciples? This was a crucial moment, immediately before his betrayal and death. Surely, at such a decisive time of crisis, he would mention only what was essential. What then did he mention at the Last Supper? Unity. May they all be one, he prayed. We seek unity because that is Christ's prayer, his desire, and his hope. But then we think of Patriarch Athanagoras' further statement, unity will be a miracle of the Holy Spirit, not just a human product, not just a manufactured article, but a gift from God. So it is our task to remove the human obstacles that hinder this divine miracle, to allow the Spirit full freedom of action. And coming on to Cardinal Sunan's words, we shall not remove these obstacles without love. And mutual love, in the true and full sense, will only be possible if there is mutual knowledge, mutual fellowship, mutual contact. Love in the abstract, love for unknown persons, is not true love. Now the unavoidable conclusion from all this is, work for unity is not an optional extra. It is fundamental. And it is the responsibility of all of us, not just of the theological experts and the church leaders, but of the people of God, the royal priesthood, in its totality. Now, in consequence of this, we should say, as divided Christians, Catholics and Orthodox, we should, so far as possible, do everything together in full cooperation. We should only do apart what we have to do apart. Alas, one of the things that to our deep sorrow we still have to do apart is the celebration of the Eucharist. On both sides we recognize that the time for intercommunion has not yet come. But it will come, if only on our part we will open our hearts to the Holy Spirit. Progress towards unity is often slow and hesitant. I think of Shakespeare's words in The Midsummer Night's Dream. I, me, for aught that ever I could read, could ever hear, by tale or history, the course of true love never did run smooth. Alas, that applies to work for unity. But there is progress. I think of the recent papal statement by Francis Laudato Si on the responsibility we have for the world around us. And there he quotes at some length his colleague in the Orthodox Church, Patriarch Bartholomew, the ecumenical patriarch. I think that is the first time in history that a Pope has quoted an Orthodox churchman in an official statement. And I find that deeply encouraging. But things do move slowly. A leading Russian Orthodox theologian, Father Georges Florovsky, says the greatest ecumenical virtue is patience. But I would add an impatient patience. So let me end with some words of Pope Francis. Every time we put behind us our long-standing prejudices and find the courage to build new human relationships, we confess that Christ is truly risen. So I end by exchanging the Paschal greeting with you that we use in the Orthodox Church. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Thank you.
Councils that the West has had, you know, we kind of drift in the direction, as you pointed about, First Vatican Council, etc. So there are traditions in both churches. Now, in the East, with so many of the Eastern churches are national churches, or at least defined that way, the Greek, the Russian, etc.
Yes.
What's the history in terms of unity of faith when you have these the different churches? Is there any distinctions? Are there any discussions? Is there any, you know, divisions in terms of even your jurisdiction or maybe policies and things like that?
Yes. When Orthodox are challenged, what is your faith? Where do we find it expressed? They would normally say in Scripture and in the seven ecumenical councils. The last of those councils met in the year 787. Has nothing happened in the following 1200 years? The answer to that is things have indeed happened. And therefore, just as the West has councils since the division between our churches, so also the East has its councils. The difference is that we Orthodox have not called any of these later councils, since the separation of the churches, ecumenical or universal councils, whereas the West has had quite a number of ecumenical councils. Now, the chief Orthodox councils, which we would certainly have to take into account if we are considering what the Orthodox Church believes, are first of all the councils that met in the 14th century, 1341 and 1351, during what was then called the Hesychast Controversy. And these councils endorsed the theology of St. Gregory of Palamas, concerning the distinction in God between his essence and his energies. Some Catholics in the past, at any rate, considered these councils to be erroneous, even heretical, though I think today most Catholics would consider that there is nothing contrary to Catholic teaching in these councils, though a different terminology is used by Palamas from that say of St. Thomas Aquinas. But then we also have Orthodox councils in the 17th century when Orthodoxy was brought face to face with the Protestant world. And this made it necessary for the Orthodox to define more closely what they meant by the Church and its authority. So, for the Orthodox doctrine of the Church, which was not something discussed explicitly by the seven ecumenical councils, we would go to various councils in the 17th century. And the movement towards conciliar meetings certainly continues in the Orthodox Church. We are at present preparing for what is called the Holy and Great Council, and it is planned that this should meet in the year 2016. If it does meet, it will be the first time that we've had a council since the ecumenical councils that represents the whole Orthodox Church, because the Palamite councils in the 14th century and the other councils that met in the 17th century were not universal councils, they were only local councils. But now perhaps we are going to have a general council, and this will be a very notable event for the Orthodox after more than a millennium that we are going to get together. We have suffered as Orthodox far too much from mutual isolation of our different churches. The nationalist ethnic element has been overemphasized, though I would say nationalism can be a good thing if it's kept within proper limits. The Church does indeed bless patriotism, love of our native land with its tradition, but this is secondary to Catholic unity, and we Orthodox need to express more fully our unity over and above the national differences. We need to break down the mutual isolation of the different national churches. And if the Holy and Great Council does meet next year, then indeed this could be a very important event for bearing witness to the universality of Orthodoxy. Yes.
Excellency, I've always appreciated your openness and your writings, and I'm just wondering if your dove-like wings are hiding under those robes. They seem to be.
Yeah.
I belong to one of the Eastern Catholic Churches, the Maronite Catholic Church, and as such, we have a patriarch. And my question is, what is your, how do you see the abandonment of the term Patriarch of the West recently by the Bishop of Rome?
As an Orthodox, I greatly regret the omission of this title. The Ravenna statement, even though it's not been adopted due to the opposition of the Russians as an agreed document, offers a very helpful approach to authority in the Church. The Ravenna statement, which was accepted by all the Orthodox except the Russians at the time and by all the Catholic delegates, this distinguishes three levels of authority. The first level is the primacy and authority of the local bishop in his own diocese. The second level is regional primacy, which for Orthodox means the primacy of the heads of the different Orthodox churches, whether they're called patriarch or archbishop or metropolitan. And then Ravenna says there is the universal primacy of the Pope. Now this is a major step forward, because in the past some Orthodox have altogether denied that the Pope has universal primacy, and they merely considered him the senior of the patriarchs. But at Ravenna, at any rate, all the Orthodox present, the Russians were absent, accepted this threefold distinction, local, regional, universal. And they accepted, therefore, that the Pope has a special ministry, not the same as that of his brother patriarchs. Now, in the West, in the last millennium, there has been a tendency to neglect the level of regional primacy. And many papal documents speak simply of the College of Bishops and the Pope, but they ignore the possibility that there might be an intermediate level of regional primacy. And in discarding the title Patriarch of the West, Pope Benedict seems to go along with this approach, to deny regional primacy, to suggest there is nothing between the diocesan bishop and the Pope. This, to us Orthodox, is regrettable. We are willing, or many of us are, to accept the idea of a universal papal primacy, but we would see it as the summit of a pyramid, and below it there is the level of regional primacy. And the papal universal primacy can only be understood if it's seen in the context also of regional primacy. So this rejection of the title Patriarch of the West suggests that Rome doesn't take seriously the level of regional primacy, the different patriarchates and autocephalous churches. And that, I think, is going to make discussions of unity more difficult. They said when they withdrew the, or when the Pope stopped using the title Patriarch of the West, it was said by the in a statement by the Council for Christian Unity that this was done because the title Patriarch of the West had no very precise meaning. Well, in that case, my comment would be, don't throw the title away, but define it more clearly.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Reverend, I have two questions in one. First of all, you mentioned the whole Orthodox world. Do you include the non-Byzantine churches, the Church of Persia, for example, the churches in India, Ethiopia, and so on? And my second question is, Moscow is the third Rome, or claims to be the third Rome. Now, would the Patriarch of Moscow consent to participate in the Pan-Orthodox Council, in which the Archbishop of Constantinople has the main chair?
Yes, certainly. The that question was,
the
Oriental Churches, yes. No, when I spoke of the Orthodox Church, I was thinking in the narrower sense of those who might be called Byzantine Orthodox. That is to say, the Patriarchate of Constantinople and the other patriarchates that are in communion with it, and the other national churches. So I was using Orthodox in that restricted sense. I would say that the Eastern Rite Catholics, among whom I have many good friends, are in fact part of the Roman Catholic Church in the sense that they are in communion with the Bishop of Rome. And I would speak of the Oriental churches or the non-Chalcedonian churches as being separate from the Orthodox Church to which I belong. The non-Chalcedonian churches would be in Egypt, the Coptic Church, in Ethiopia, in Armenia, and also the Syrian Orthodox Church, which exists in Syria and in India. Now, they form the family of the Oriental churches, but they are separated at the moment from the Orthodox Church to which I belong, though there have been very constructive discussions. So, when I spoke of the Orthodox Church, I was using it in a restricted sense, not to include the Eastern Rite Catholics, not to include the non-Chalcedonian Orthodox. But I recognize the bonds that exist between these three families. Then Moscow the Third Rome. The uh, the Orthodox Church as a whole has never endorsed this particular theory. The theory runs, you have the first Rome on the banks of the Tiber, and that church fell into false doctrine. And so the primacy was transferred to the second church, the second Rome, the new Rome, Constantinople. But then Constantinople fell into heresy when it accepted union with Rome at the Council of Florence. And so the primacy was transferred to Russia, which is the third and last Rome, and a fourth there shall not be. That's the theory. Now, the Patriarchate of Constantinople and Greek-speaking Orthodox churches, and one would say also Romania, Serbia, Bulgaria, have never accepted this theory in its completeness. The head of the Russian church is indeed a patriarch, but he ranks fifth after Constantinople, after Alexandria, Antioch, and Jerusalem. On the theory of the third Rome, pressed to extremes, it would be argued that he had replaced the patriarch of Constantinople, and that we have never accepted. So the title, the third Rome, can only be accepted in a very modified sense. Yes, following the fall of Constantinople in 1453, it was the Church of Russia that assumed external leadership in the Orthodox world. But the Patriarch of Constantinople had always retained his position as the first among equals in the Orthodox Church. And the Church of Russia has never denied that. Extreme exponents of the Russian Orthodox point of view may have suggested that the Patriarch of Moscow replaces the ecumenical patriarch. But so far as the official teaching of the Church goes, it is recognized that the ecumenical patriarch has the first place. And I do not think that is seriously disputed by anybody in the Russian Church today. So if the Holy and Great Council meets, the chair will indeed be taken by the Patriarch of Constantinople. And I have every hope that that will be accepted by the Church of Russia.
Yes, Your Honor. Two brief questions. On the Eastern churches, about 10 years ago, Pope John Paul put out a directive that the Eastern churches move more closely back to their original origins, tradition, theology, usage, as a way of coming back to the roots.
Yes.
Two questions there. First, has there been any movement on the part of any of the Eastern churches back towards Orthodoxy? And secondly, has there been any statements or policy on the part of the Orthodox churches with regard to how to reapproach, in spite of all the difficulties, the Eastern church that exists, especially in places like Ukraine, where they're so Slovakia, where they're so closely related to the Orthodox world. That's the first question. Second is, you have said in this lecture, every time you mention the Great Council of hopefully 2016, you've always said, if it takes place, what is the stumbling block that may prevent it from taking place?
Well, let's take up the second question, because it's first, it's more specific. The discussion about holding a Holy and Great Council has been going on in the Orthodox Church for many decades, and it has been constantly postponed. So my fear is that it might be postponed again. No, I hope not. That's why I say if. There is an obstacle at the moment in that there is a quarrel going on between the Patriarchate of Antioch and that of Jerusalem over who has the pastoral oversight of Qatar. And both churches have sent bishops to Qatar. And the Patriarchate of Antioch has objected to this and has broken off communion with the Patriarchate of Jerusalem. Jerusalem has taken a more moderate line, and they have said, we defend our right to send a bishop to Qatar, but we are not breaking off communion with anybody. Now, the Patriarchate of Antioch has threatened that unless this question is settled to their satisfaction, they will not come to the Holy and Great Council. And that would make it very difficult to hold such a council if a senior patriarchate in this way abstained. So there is that problem to be faced. And that's why I'm a little cautious. You were asking more generally about our attitude to the Eastern Catholic Church. Back at Balamand, one of the earlier meetings in the early 90s between the Catholics and the Orthodox, it was said that Unitism is not the way forward to unity, and that the Catholics would renounce this in the future. Now, the Eastern Catholic Churches were not at all happy about this decision. What I think the Balamand statement meant was, Unitism means absorbing part of different Orthodox churches into the Catholic Church, thus dividing them from their Catholic Church membership. And this was what happened in the late 16th, 17th, and early 18th centuries in Ukraine, in Czechoslovakia, in Lebanon and Syria. And this meant unity was established at the expense of causing a schism. And so I think the Balamand decision meant that this would not be the way that the Catholics would pursue in the future, of trying to dislodge particular Orthodox churches or splitting their membership. That this does harm rather than good. But the Eastern Catholic Churches exist, and they have the right to exist. And if we Orthodox were more generous, we might well see that they are our best friends in the Catholic Church. I have good contact with many Eastern Rite Catholics. And so I do not myself subscribe to the somewhat hostile tendency found among some Orthodox towards the Eastern Catholics. They are an aspect of Roman Catholic teaching. After all, the Roman Catholic Church believes itself to be the one true church, and so it sees itself as entitled to absorb Eastern Christians into its membership. By the same token, we Orthodox also regard ourselves as the one true church. And attempts have been made, though rather tentative and on a small scale, to establish Western Rite Orthodox churches, Unitism in reverse. But I don't think myself that this is the way forward towards unity. So I think that deals with part of your question. I hope so. Yes. Behind. Yes, please.
Your Excellency, could you explain the principle of economy and how that might apply to some of us who hope that the coming October city in Rome might reach out to the lost and the married in the Catholic Church?
Put in the simplest possible terms, economy in Orthodox canon law means departing from the strict letter of the law departing from it almost always in the direction of greater leniency, where this is going to help the salvation of souls. To give you a non-controversial example of economy, the canons of the early church say no one should be ordained deacon until they are 25, and no one should be ordained priest until they are 30. Now, in practice, both in the Catholic Church and in the Orthodox Church, this rule is not observed, and people are ordained at a younger age. So this would be an example of economy, where the strict letter of the law, the canon law, was set aside and the relaxation was allowed. Now, how does economy apply to marriage? Sometimes it is said that the Orthodox practice of permitting divorce in certain situations is an exercise of economy. That is not strictly accurate, because the canons, the strictness of the canons, the letter of the canons, does allow for divorce for certain reasons, in particular in the case of adultery, allowing for the exception mentioned in Christ's teaching in the Gospel of Matthew. So the granting of divorce in itself, in accordance with the canons, is not an example of economy. But in practice, the Orthodox grant divorce for broader reasons. If it is evident in the church courts that there has been an irrevocable breakdown of human relationships, and there is no prospect of restoring that, then the court may well decide to grant people a release and allow them to remarry. And this could be seen extending the rules for divorce as an exercise of economy. So the rules for divorce in themselves are envisaged by the canons, but only for a limited case. So when we grant divorces today in the Orthodox Church, often, but not always, it is an exercise of economy, because we do it for reasons not strictly covered by the canons, when there is evidence that the marriage has become a dead letter. And we believe it is more merciful, more Christ-like, to allow people a second chance than to treat marriage as a life sentence. So, so I think that the references that have been made by the Pope and others to the Orthodox practice, and mentioning this as an example of economy, this can be accepted in a broad sense, though it has to be qualified in practice. I don't know if that clarifies things a little.
Yes.
Talking of grounds for divorce according to the canons, one such ground of divorce is leprosy. And I remember in Oxford, one of the Russian Orthodox there giving a talk to non-Orthodox about marriage and divorce. And he spoke for about 10 minutes concerning marriage in highly idealistic terms as a perfect union of two souls. And then he said in a sad voice, much to the surprise of his audience, sometimes there are things which make this perfect union difficult. Such as leprosy. Well, in our society, leprosy is not the most often would occur to us, but it is here.
It seems like you talked about ecumenical dialogue is moving slowly. One place I think that it's moved slower even than the official dialogue is on the grassroots level. Simple internet search of Orthodox Roman Catholic humanism dialogue would probably give you sites against such dialogue. You either written by Grace or Landy. So what more do you think could be done with filtering some of the advances that have been made at a hierarchical level to go out of Landy?
Yes, this is a real challenge for us. It has to be said that our dialogues often seem to be carried on in a vacuum, and there is a real need to bring the findings of our dialogues to the grassroots level. Unity will not come to pass until there is a burning, ardent, fervent desire in the whole Christian people for unity. And this doesn't exist very much at the moment. Though some lay people would say, why can't we just unite now? Why do we have to bother about all these theological points? But there is an attitude among the laity which is in favor of unity and of unity now and immediately. But we have to work to make our negotiations better known. There is the question of reception. For example, after 18 years of discussion, the Catholic Orthodox dialogue, sorry, the Anglican Orthodox dialogue produced a statement on the nature of the Church, 118 pages. In my view, a very good statement, but it's a whole treatise rather than a short convergence document. And I wonder how many of you in this room have read that statement. The Triune Church of God. Yes.
I have read it.
You have read it.
But I do have a question along that line.
Congratulations. Usually, when I ask that question of audiences, nobody raises that. And that exactly illustrates the fact that we need to let the results of our discussions penetrate through to the total Christian people, because unity cannot be only a matter for church leaders and theological experts. It must be something involving the total people of God. But how we do that, it's not so easy to say. I think on that slightly despondent.
One more question.
Let's have one more question.
One more question, and rather peripheral to anything deeply theological. I've been in Cuba two times in the past couple of years before the recent agreements with the United States, and I was very struck by the fact that the Roman Catholic Church is, if we think of Cuba as a Roman Catholic Church oriented country, as best it could be, but I was struck by the presence of how many Orthodox churches there are in Cuba. And I wanted to know what dominion they're under, what patriarch they're under, or how, what their relationship is with the government, etc.
There you touch on a very difficult point. I'm not familiar myself with the situation in Cuba, but I imagine that the different Orthodox parishes depend on different mother churches.